nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Welcome back. I'm Professor Rickus. In this lecture, we're going to examine the design of photoreceptors as a biosensor, as a cellular device. We're going to ask ourselves, what are the design principles that we can extract and use in human-engineered biosensors, and what we can learn from photoreceptors? So in today's lecture, we'll talk about, we'll look at this case study of the vertebrate rod photoreceptor. We'll look at its performance as a single photon detector, and particularly highlight some of the design features of that cell that allows its performance, particularly the molecular stability, the stacked and packed microarchitecture, and amplification via signaling cascades. So here I have an image of an isolated photoreceptor rod from a salamander. And if we look at the performance of this photoreceptor as a sensor, the limited detection can detect a single photon. It has incredibly low dark noise. It can harvest power from its environment, essentially via bioenergy. It has a dynamic range that adapts to the signals that it encounters. You know this intuitively. If you walk into a dark room and then walk out into sunlight, you sort of have that time for your eyes to adjust. And that's your retina and the photoreceptors at the cellular level adjusting their dynamic range. Its accuracy, it's a near perfect photon counter. And its composition, it's comprised of organic biological parts. So I would argue that our photoreceptors rival our man-made solid-state photodetectors. And looking at it from this view, is a photoreceptor an ultimate bioengineered microdevice? So what design features enable this amazing sensing performance in the photoreceptor? Well, it involves both molecular properties and events. It also involves the self-assembled architecture of the cell, as well as the signaling cascade. So here I have a cartoon of a photoreceptor rod, and here we can see disks that are organized in an outer segment of the rod. This is where the photon is absorbed. There's an inner segment now where you can see the mitochondria of the cell that are involved in the energy production of the cell, the nucleus where we were involved in gene expression, and then we have synaptic endings where neurotransmitter is released from the rod to communicate to the rest of the retina and onto the brain, the photon events that were detected up in the outer segment. So the basic steps of phototransduction, light is absorbed by rhodopsin in this protein disc. There's a signaling cascade that happens in the cell that closes sodium channels in the outer segment. The cell then hyperpolarizes, so the membrane potential of the cell decreases, and then the synaptic release of neurotransmitter to the other cells in the retina that then signal on to the brain decreases. Okay, so we have a change in events from an input, photon absorbed, to the ultimate output of the cell, neurotransmitter, changes in neurotransmitter release. Okay, so let's look a little bit closer at step one. So light is absorbed by rhodopsin in the disc. Now rhodopsin is a membrane protein. It has 7 transmembrane domains. So these are these domains that sits in this lipid bilayer and has these 7 domains that span this lipid bilayer range. It contains a retinal chromophore that this is the molecule that absorbs the light. And this photon absorption event is transduced by activating G protein coupled signaling events from this protein into the cell. So this brings us to our first design feature, and that is molecular stability, which gives us very low background noise. So when this retinol molecule in rhodopsin absorbs a photon, there's an isomerization event. So we go from cis retinol to an all trans state. And this happens in the order of picoseconds. So the key here is that if there were a lot of spontaneous isomerization, we wouldn't be able to distinguish that from a photon event. So that essentially contributes noise to the system. But in here, our spontaneous isomerization rate of cis retinol to trans is about 10 to the 23 times, that's many, many, many orders of magnitude, slower than the photo-induced isomerization event. So this results in an extremely low background noise and contributes to our ability to accurately detect a single photon event, right, with low false positive events and have a low detection limit. Now let's look at the next design feature. I also said that the architecture of the cell is very important. So that's great if we can detect a single photon, only if that single photon actually results in an event, actually encounters a retinol. And that's where the architecture comes in. So in this outer segment, we have discs that are organized in the outer segment of the rod. In a monkey rod, for example, there are about 750 discs that are packed in this space. Here you can see an electron micrograph of these discs that are organized and all lined up. And there are about 10 to the 8th retinol molecules, or 100 million retinol molecules in a rod. And about 80% of the disc protein is rhodopsin. So in this outer rod, we have highly packed receptors, and there's layers of them, right? So this packing increases the probability that a single photon will get absorbed and not missed. And so this performance, right, this leads us, helps to enable a single photon detection limit, result in low false negatives. In other words, that you don't miss the signal. Okay, so we still have a challenge, right? If one photon activates one receptor out of 100 million, so it's a very reliable and clean event, but we still have a little bit of a needle in the haystack problem. Somehow we have to translate that one photon was absorbed by this one molecule into something that the brain recognizes as, I need to pay attention to that. So it would be a little bit like I lobbed a baseball into a crowd of 100 million people, right? Somebody's gonna catch it, right? All these people packed in, I throw in, somebody's gonna see it and catch it or pick it up. But the problem is, how will the catcher report to the stage, the stage is like our brain, that he or she caught it? So this brings us to design feature number 3, and that is amplification in the signaling cascade. So let's look a little bit of the signaling cascade, what happens between that photon getting absorbed by the rhodopsin to those sodium channels closing and resulting in a change in neurotransmitter release. Okay, so when rhodopsin absorbs that photon, right, and we've got that isomerization event, well, it causes a change in the rhodopsin protein. And we said that it's a G protein coupled receptor, right? So this G protein, and we've got this transducin molecule now. So transducin GDP gets converted to transducin GTP, right? And then we have an alpha subunit from the G protein that it goes to affect the enzymatic rate and function of an enzyme, a phosphodiesterase. So it's typically inhibited, and we need this alpha subunit of transducin to go and activate phosphodiesterase. So once the phosphodiesterase is activated, each of one of those enzymes hydrolyzes an event converting cyclic GMP into a hydrolyzed form, okay? And that cyclic GMP is what regulates the conductance, the opening and closing of those sodium channels. So we've got a couple points of amplification in this signaling cascade. So one isomerization event can result ultimately in the hydrolysis of 10 to the 5 cyclic GMPs. Okay? So one metarhodopsin, which has undergone that isomerization event in its retinol, catalyzes many of these GTP exchanges on transducin. So we've got one level of amplification or gain there. Down here, our phosphodiesterase enzyme can hydrolyze many molecules of cyclic GMP, a second major point of gain or amplification. Again, bringing this to one isomerization event, one photon, right, that results in 10 to the 5 cyclic GMPs that then goes on, one photon can therefore close many sodium channels. The conductance of a single channel is about 0.1 picosiemens, and that can effectively dramatically change the the membrane potential of our cell and close those channels, those sodium channels, and affect neurotransmitter release, which the rest of the retina and the brain detects as an event. So this helps our biosensor performance in terms of good sensitivity and low detection limit from the ultimate user, our brain. So looking at this all summarized in sort of a cellular form of these events, in the dark, cyclic GMP normally activates those sodium channels, which are open. So we have a constant dark current. And in that dark, the cells are depolarized, and we get a high release of neurotransmitter. In the light now, to summarize, those sodium channels close, right? We have reducing the current across the cell membrane. The cells hyperpolarize. So light is inversely proportional to the amount of cyclic GMP, and cyclic GMP is proportional to the membrane potential of the cell, where VM here I've indicated is membrane potential of the cell, which regulates the neurotransmitter that's released from the photoreceptor. Okay, so now back to our metaphor. One person now that caught that ball has a very powerful microphone that says, "Hey, I caught it," right? So that microphone that gives that amplification to that person's voice, our signaling cascade gives that amplification to that photon, "Hey, I caught it" event, so that the stage could know someone caught the softball. But remember, noise gets amplified too. So alone, amplification wouldn't be enough, right? So back to those earlier design principles, that low dark noise is also very critical for the amplification to work well. If everybody was, yeah, yeah, and everybody had a microphone, then the stage wouldn't be able to distinguish it. But we've got everybody else quiet, right? By very low background noise. And now our amplification can easily be resolved by the stage or our brain. So, sort of to make a point here, you know, engineers, you often will hear in a lot of statements that engineers like to state that nature or evolution is not an engineer, or that it's an awkward or inefficient engineer. Meaning that, you know, a human engineer to design de novo a system would arrive at a more elegant and optimal solution to the problem. But in this case, I would say that biology is still out-engineering us in many ways. We have very few biosensors that have been designed, for example, with changing dynamic range, which we didn't get a chance to talk about today. And that comes from other design features in the signaling cascade as well. But that's an example, right, that I think engineers, we still have a lot to learn from biology. We can't yet design or haven't yet designed cellular sensors that outperform the photoreceptor. So I think there's a lot we can learn and extract some of these principles to create the next generation of cellular biosensors or cell-inspired biosensors. So I'm going to end you with a thought challenge here. So how could you extract or mimic the design features of photoreceptors to produce an engineered biosensor to detect, say, toxins or contaminants in a water stream, as an example, or levels of drugs circulating through a patient's blood? So think about this and see if you can come up with some novel solutions. So coming up, we're going to move into cell and organelle size and number, and specifically we're going to talk about what are the design principles that cells use to regulate their size and number. So I hope to see you next time. Thanks.